everybody. Can you hear me good?
Yes.
Well, yes. Thank the Lord. Sister, today is the day that the Lord has made. We're going to be glad in it, and we're going to rejoice. Amen. This morning, Pam Shavira is going to help me out this morning. Pam, you ready?
Yes. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. Can you hear that?
Yes.
Glory, glory, hallelujah.
Hey.
Since I laid my burdens down. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Since I laid my burdens down.
You've always wanted to know how you can give to the ministry? Pastor, tell us more about it.
How many of you know that the more you give to God, the more God gives to you? And what about this? That you really cannot beat God giving, no matter how you try. You ever heard that before? You ever taken God at God's word and tried God? This is our opportunity now to see if God's word is true. If we bring the full tithe into the storehouse and put God to the test, will God take care of us even during a global pandemic when the economy is down and tragedy is commonplace and people are suffering all around? Why don't we try and see if we get a testimony from our tithing? Why don't you take a moment now and get your checkbook out and get ready to write your check so that you can mail it in to Bethel AME Church, P.O. Box 2236, Fontana, California, 92334. Again, if you're mailing a check, it's to Bethel AME Church, P.O. Box 2236, Fontana, California, 92334. You also have a host of electronic giving choices. You can use Cash App at Bethel AME Fontana, or use Givelify at Bethel AME Fontana, or use PayPal at BethelAMEFontana.org and use the donate button on our website. So again, our handle at Cash App and Givelify is Bethel AME Fontana. You can also visit our website at BethelAMEFontana.org. Now listen, God wants us to test God in this one area and see if God won't open up the windows of heaven and pour out blessings that we don't have room enough to receive. It is true. The more we give, the more God gives to us. Thank you so much for giving back to God what God has given to you.
I'm going to play it here on my end. Here is Speak to My Heart.
Can you hear me?
Talk to me. Thank you.
Glory. Hallelujah. Thank you so much. You are a blessing. You have blessed us indeed. Thank you, Garland. You know, I've been waiting for that for a long time. And then when I came to the service and you all were celebrating your beloved and you sang, I said, ooh, he holding out. So thank you. Thank you for using your gifts to bless the household of faith today in Bethel. We are so grateful to you. Indeed, there is a word from the Lord. And so we want to share today from Isaiah chapter 59. And our focus verses are on 1 and 2 and verses 8 and 9. Let us pray. God, our God, how excellent is thy name in all of the earth. There is no place, God, where your name is not excellent indeed. We thank you for the presence of your Holy Spirit. And now we have one ask, that you would speak to our hearts, God, that you would talk to us in this moment where we meet your word and it meets us, God. Hide me behind the cross. Turn my voice into your voice, oh God, that you would crawl into our hearts, that you would cover us with your glory, God, that you would fill our fingertips and our feet with your presence. Speak to our hearts that we will all be changed. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Isaiah chapter 59, verses 1 and 2 and verses 8 and 9. See, the Lord's hand is not too short to save, nor his ear too dull to hear. Rather, your iniquities have been barriers between you and your God, and your sins have hidden God's face from you so that God does not hear. Jumping to verse 8, the way of peace they do not know, and there is no justice in their paths. Their roads they have made crooked. No one who walks in them knows peace. Therefore, justice is far from us, and righteousness does not reach us. We wait for light, and lo, there is darkness, and for brightness, but we walk in gloom. Many of you know that I used to have two girl dogs from the same litter, Grace and Mercy. When I first brought them home, they both fit in the same carrying bag and shared the same crate. They were adorable little 2-pound Shih Tzu puppies. They did everything together: eat, sleep, poop, and pee. They were so cute and playful and peaceful. And then one day, as they grew, the peaceful play turned into an attempted murder. I'm not sure what got it started. I think it might have been that as they grew, they were feeling cramped in their now too small cage, and a power struggle ensued. I'm not exactly sure, but they went after each other so fiercely that they drew blood. Grace almost clawed out Mercy's left eye. And when I tried to separate them, they drew my blood too. I finally got them apart, and I made sure that we did not need an emergency trip to the veterinarian. I thought that by physically separating them, I had stopped the fight. There was no more opportunity for physical altercation, and so I thought I had achieved peace between them. It turns out I was wrong. They basically laid in wait for one another to finish that fight. And there was nothing that I could have done to stop them. Although I had missed what started it, they had not missed it. They were not going to be done fighting until they had reached a place where they felt justice had been served. Grace was going to get what was coming to her from Mercy, and Mercy was going to get what was coming to her before there would be any rest in the house. Sometimes the conflict between them lasted for days, with each of them being on edge until they finally battled it out. Over the years, I learned that I could cry for peace and separate them as much as I wanted. But until they had resolved the underlying conflict between themselves, there would be no peace. For the next few minutes, I want you to focus with me on the subject: no justice, no peace. No justice, no peace. In our text this morning, we hear the voice of God responding to the cry of the people for peace and their accusation that God has abandoned them. And basically what God says to the people of Israel is, there is no peace for the wicked. You can cry for peace all you want, but until you turn from your wicked ways, you will not have peace. Let's look again at verses 1 and 2. See, the Lord's hand is not too short to save, nor his ear too dull to hear. Rather, your iniquities have been barriers between you and your God, and your sins have hidden God's face from you so that God does not hear. The arm, the Lord's hand, the Lord's arm is the symbol of personal action, God's ability to reach in. And the ear that we're talking about in the text symbolizes God's ability and willingness to hear us when we pray. And what this text says is that God's arm is not too short to reach and act for deliverance. And God's ears are not broken. The problem is the sin of the people causing separation and alienation from God. God can hear, but basically God is saying, talk to the hand. God is personally offended and alienated, and it shows on God's face. Y'all know how you know me, and you'd send me little text messages, Francine, fix your face. Well, in this situation, God's face is set against the people of Israel, and there is no fixing of God's face. We have offended God with our personal and our collective sin, and so God will not hear from us. You know how the scripture says that the prayer of the righteous availeth much? Well, this is sort of the opposite of that. The prayers of the unrighteous will not be heard by the righteous God. Sin has alienated us. God has turned away from us. God is not listening to the people of Israel. Have you ever had a fight with somebody you love and you've been offended by something that they have done or failed to do, or something they have said or failed to say? And the day after the fight, you remember everything that happened and you realize that things were said and done that cannot be ignored. And you actually never want that person to speak to you again or touch you again, for that matter. At least for me, when that happened, it resulted in a divorce. and I have not spoken to my ex-husband in over 20 years. I'm talking this morning about no justice, no peace. We were not able to resolve the conflict in any way that resulted in our ability to continue sharing space. Let me say that again. We were not able to resolve the conflict in any way that resulted in our ability to continue sharing space. Like Grace and Mercy, we're not going back into that crate until they worked it out. We were not able to go back into the crate because we could not work it out. And thank God we had the choice to just move out of the crate. But beloved, we can't live that way with God. The wages of sin are death. Living lives that are separated from God, where God's face is set against us, where we are constantly offending the God who made us and who knows the plans that God has made for us, will cause us to live a life of torment, of anxiety, of fear, of rage, of destruction and defeat. We got to work out the conflict we have with God. Our arms are too short to box with God. We have to turn from our wicked ways and we have to seek to live justly so that God will hear from us and extend God's arm to save us and grant us peace. We have to seek to resolve the underlying conflict with God so that we can have peace. No justice, no peace, no justice, no peace. Verses 8 and 9 say that the way of peace they do not know, and there is no justice in their paths. Their roads they have made crooked, and no one who walks in them knows peace. Verse 9, therefore justice is far from us, and righteousness does not reach us. We wait for light, and lo, there is darkness, and for brightness. But all we do is walk in gloom. Beloved, if we want to walk in the light of God's countenance and in the light of God's glory, and if we want to see God's face and not have God's hand talking to us, if we want God to hear us, then we're going to need to get right with God in our own lives, and we're going to need to work for justice in our homes, in our churches, and in our communities. If we want peace, we're going to have to work through some conflicts. We are not going to be able to run away from the conflict. We can't get a divorce from God, or like we can, but it's not advisable. We can't continue to live in denial about the problems. We're going to have to face the challenges head on and stay at the table to work through them. What do you mean, preacher? Well, I mean that as long as we seek to live in a house built on racism, sexism, classism, and violence, we shall not have peace because the crate is too small for us. As long as we try to live in a world where one person has to be suffocated in order for another person to breathe, then we will not have peace. As long as we try to solve problems through segregation and separating people, even mass incarceration type separations, even deportation type separations, as long as we try to solve problems through segregation and separating people who cannot work it out with one another, we will not have peace. Do you hear me? We will not have peace as long as on Sunday mornings we're more divided than we've ever been. I think there's a reason that God has shut down the doors that separate us on Sunday morning and move the church to the world wide web, because unless we can work it out, unless we can resolve the conflict together, we will not have peace. We are inextricably linked. We are in this thing together. We will rise or fall together. If we want peace, we're going to have to seek to resolve the underlying conflicts with God and with one another. No justice, no peace. You can't abandon people in nursing homes and put your hope in young people and expect God to grant peace. You can't throw people away in prison and leave their families to fend for themselves and live comfortably in our homes and have peace. We can't continue to deny people access to clean water, food, housing, and education, love and respect, and expect that God is going to answer our prayers for peace. God is not mocked. The Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King said it this way: the demand for dignity, equality, jobs, and citizenship will not be abandoned or diluted or postponed. If that means resistance and conflict, we shall not flinch. We shall not be cowed. We are no longer afraid. No justice, no peace. We will take direct action against injustice despite the failure of governmental and other official agencies to act first. We will not obey unjust laws or submit to unjust practices. We will do this peacefully, openly, cheerfully, because our aim is to persuade. We adopt the means of nonviolence because our end is a community at peace with ourselves. We will try to persuade with our words, but if our words fail, we will try to persuade with our acts. We will always be willing to talk and seek fair compromise, but we are ready to suffer when necessary and even risk our lives to become witnesses to truth as we see it. King closed his Nobel lecture on December 11th, 1964 with these words. Let me close by saying that I have the personal faith that humankind will somehow rise up to the occasion and give new directions to an age drifting rapidly to its doom. In spite of the tensions and uncertainties of this period, something profoundly meaningful is taking place. Old systems of exploitation and oppression are passing away. And out of the womb of a frail world, new systems of justice and equality are being born. Doors of opportunity are gradually being opened to those at the bottom of society. This is what he said December 11th, 1964. The shirtless and barefoot people of the land are developing a new sense of somebody-ness and carving a tunnel of hope through the dark mountain of despair. The people who sat in darkness have seen a great light. Here and there, an individual or group dares to love and rises to the majestic heights of moral maturity. So in a real sense, this is a great time to be alive. This is what he said December 11th, 1964. Therefore, he said, I am not yet discouraged about the future. Granted that the easygoing optimism of yesterday is impossible. Granted that those who pioneer in the struggle for peace and freedom will still face uncomfortable jail terms, painful threats of death. They will still be battered by the storms of persecution, leading them to the nagging feeling that they can no longer bear such a heavy burden and the temptation of wanting to retreat to a more quiet and serene life. Granted that we face a world crisis, yeah, which leaves us standing so often amid the surging murmur of life's restless sea. But every crisis has both its dangers and its opportunities. That's what he said December 11th, 1964. And it can spell either salvation or doom. In a dark, confused world, the kingdom of God may yet reign in the hearts of men. And I'll add women because he left them out. Now, let me leave you with these thoughts on June 28th, 2020. In the midst of a global health pandemic and the impending fall of democracy, we cannot find peace by avoiding conflict. No justice, no peace. The pathway to peace is paved with justice. We have to face our problems to fix them. Let there be peace on earth, and let it begin with us, with our personal commitment to work through the personal sins that separate us from God. In Sunday school, we talked about the foolish woman, the scoffers who do not want to hear from wisdom.
Let us seek to humble ourselves and to grow and allow God to get us right with God. Let's confess our personal sins, our pride, our arrogance, our greed, our selfishness, our individualism, our narrow-mindedness. We're so arrogant about what we think we know and who we think we are. We're going to have to get right with God in our personal lives. And then we're going to have to make a new commitment, a collective commitment, to work for justice until we find peace. To work for justice until we find peace. When we have known justice, we will know peace. When we have known justice, we will know peace.
No peace.
So let me extend to you an invitation. This invitation is simple. Get right with God and do it now. God's arm is not too short to save. God's ears are not stopped up. It is that we have offended God, and God ain't gonna fix God's face toward us until we get right with God. No justice, no peace. If you're accepting this invitation, the personal invitation, to give your life to Christ again, even if you're already saved, but to go back to the altar and try to surrender some more of the stuff that separates you from God. Or if you have stopped in the struggle for justice, you have decided to think that it is not about you and it's those people's problems over there. Coronavirus should tell us that. That's wrong. That's stinking thinking. That's not how God works. We're in this thing together. When God took out Sodom and Gomorrah, it was a whole city, not just a household. We're in this thing together. Coronavirus teaches us that better than anything else. We are in a common breath all over this world. If you're saying yes to this invitation, put something in the chat so we can follow up with you, or send us an email so that we can follow up with you to talk about this change that is coming into your life right now. Let us pray. God, our God, we come confessing that we mess up daily. If we had to be incarcerated for every time we have sinned against you, if somebody could lock us up and throw away the key for every time, God, that we have violated one of the Ten Commandments, for every time, God, that we have failed to love our neighbor as we have loved ourselves, for every time we have looked at somebody else's suffering and not done everything in our power to try to alleviate it, God, we are sorry. We confess that we are sinners, and we are grateful that your grace is sufficient and you allow us to come to you, to turn from our wicked ways, to seek your face, God. And you have promised us that when we do that, when we humble ourselves and when we turn, you will open up your ears and you will turn your face towards us. And so, God, we ask you to turn your face towards those who are seeking to be saved this morning. We ask, oh God, as a collective, that you would forgive our communities and heal this land. We ask, God, that you would put justice in the hearts and minds of people everywhere, no matter how old they are, no matter how rich or poor they are, no matter what language they speak. Put justice in the hearts of people that we will get right with you. This is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.
Are you saved? Have you ever given your life to Jesus Christ? Confessed him as your Lord and Savior? Acknowledge that you've tried to do your life on your own, tried to be Lord of your own life, in charge of your own plans and things like that, but you failed, and that you need help from beyond yourself to sometimes get yourself out of situations that you may find yourself in, and certainly to help you find your way home when this earthly tent is destroyed. Are you saved? I want to offer Christ to you today. I want you to consider the possibility that your life can be something radically different than it is now if you accept Jesus as your personal Savior. When we are weak, He is strong. When we don't know which way to go, He knows the way we should take. When we don't know how we're going to make it from day to day, He already knows what tomorrow holds. I'm offering Christ to you today. Would you pray with me? God, our God, how excellent is Thy name in all the earth. We come together humbly acknowledging, God, right now that we are sinners. We do all sorts of things that separate us from You and get ourselves into trouble. And right now we are sorry for these things that we have done or failed to do that have separated us from You, and we're asking You to save us. We're confessing that Jesus Christ is Lord, that He died for us and that He rose for us, and that because He lives, we can face tomorrow. Thank You for washing us and cleansing us and giving us a right spirit. Help us now to follow You from this day forward. Thank You for salvation, God. Thank You for a family of Christ that makes sure that we will never walk alone. Thank You. Congratulations on your brand new life with Christ.